Okay, on your Marco Polo, you mentioned that we can talk whenever. So as you heard me explaining to Jim on the previous video, I really do find this to be unique. It's not something that I do with everyone, and I appreciate it, because even though it can take quite a little bit of time to get through all the videos or to write the notes or to reply back to them, I know I don't have to reply to every subject. You know you don't have to reply to every subject, but our conversations, I feel, are good, and I feel like we're bonding and connecting and relating and therapeuting. It's really helpful, I think. I don't see anything negative with it, and so... Of course, if you ever did, don't feel obligated, and I don't think you do. I think we are on the same wavelength. You mentioned that we're on the same wavelength. So, yeah, I do like that we can do this, even though it is... And I like that I'm not rushing to get it all done in one day, and that I'm taking my time throughout the week and just doing what I feel like I can do for the night, because if I'm, you know, just needing a few minutes to talk, and then I need to process some more, or I need to budget my time better, you know what I'm saying. I wrote down, Grandma is hurting. You mentioned that she and Grandpa are not getting along, but I'm so proud of her for getting out of the house and getting... and feeling 1,000 times better, as you mentioned. Good for Dusty for grabbing her and taking her to his house. I know it sounds like she's giving up and that she's fed up. That's what you said, and that she's overstressed. I agree with you 100%. You and I understand where she's at. But if we're going to look at the silver lining on this, if she's over at Dusty's feeling 1,000% better, do you know what that means? That means she is reaching for a higher vibration. She is reaching for opportunities to feel good. And she is taking herself out of an environment where she doesn't feel good. Because you're right. If you are surrounded by negativity and toxic conversation and just anger and bitterness and resentment, you lose all hope that anything can get better. And then if you lose a spouse or someone, you don't feel like you have a reason for living. So even though Grandpa's still alive, in many ways she probably feels like she's lost a spouse. So she's having to grieve not just the loss of her sister, but also the loss of the spouse that she had always hoped he would be for her. And maybe her excuse to her in her mind was that he wasn't everything she needed him to be, because he was too busy dividing his time between Eileen and the store. And now, like you've mentioned, they're in their retirement years, and she just wants this one last thing before, you know, before their lives are done. So why can't he choose her first, ever? Now, knowing what I know about my own codependency, and knowing what you know about your own codependency, I know that no amount of needing Jim to meet a need of mine is ever going to get him to meet it for me. I can kick and scream and holler, yell and cry and bleed, and I can do whatever I need to do in that moment. It's not going to change him. So I had to learn how to stop relying on others to fix me. I had to stop relying on Jim meeting my needs in order for me to feel happy. I needed to learn how to just get happy, how to just rise my vibration, get out of the toxic conversation, get out of the toxic bedroom, get out of the toxic mentality, and just reach for the higher vibration, because there's nothing I can do to help him or help him see anything. So that's why I'm excited for Grandma to, you know what, screw you, Theron. You ain't going to listen to me. You ain't going to treat me like I'm anything valuable to you, but I'm going to go raise my vibration with grandkids and with my son and with a different environment and a different bedroom and a different scenery every day and a different conversation and a different voice going on. You know, I just think it's awesome. So I'm just really excited for her. It doesn't fix anything with Grandpa, no. But as a codependent, nothing that we do actually fixes them. We try. We sure try with our actions, yeah. So her going to see Dusty is not intended to fix him. It's only there to help her. It's only there to help her raise her vibrations to feel good enough for just a moment so that she can figure out what's next for her. I talked to a woman the other day. She wanted to take her name off of the water bill. And she's 76 years old, and she's getting divorced. She said after 30 years, so that means she got married to him in her 40s. After 30 years, she was just sick and tired of his bullshit, and she's moving on. She's moving on. And she says it's not going to be easy, but she's not going to live the rest of her life being pissed off at him and not being recognized or not being appreciated or not being whatever. I don't remember all the things that she said, but I was just so proud of her. She's 76 years old, and I was telling her I could email her the form to take her name off of the account, and she doesn't know how to email, and that's how she got to talking about her age. And I'm just like, wow, look at you, lady. It's never too late to stand up for yourself, right? It's only too late if you think it's too late, you know? Anyways, I was just really, really proud of her. Okay, and then you mentioned that, and I agree, you mentioned that when we give up, like the law of attraction, it's like we are telling the universe that we're done, and so we are in some ways attracting a way to be done with this life. And I really do think my dad attracted his cancer, because he probably had a I'm so done mentality with everything that he attracted a disease. And I'm gonna be honest with you, Di, I've had this I'm done mentality for a while, and if I attract anything besides my obesity and my mental health issues, if I attract anything more than that, I will not be surprised, because I have been so done for so long. I've had to climb out of that doneness and strive for something better. So even last night's fight, I was so done. But I believe that the universe will attract whatever you are putting out there. So I hope that all I've attracted is my mental health issues and my obesity. And I hope that I can recover from both of those, if not sooner than later. But yeah, I agree with what you were saying about attracting disease. And that is scary for Grandma. If she's that miserable going back to Pocatello, she shouldn't go back to Pocatello, because she probably will get to that point again, and that roller coaster is not healthy for her. I don't think she should go back. I think she should do what Grandpa told me about Naomi, and how Naomi got her own house and didn't tell Frank Pollard, Grandpa Pollard, about it. And Grandpa Pollard was pissed about it and was still not very happy, even when he died. I guess he died before Naomi, right? So he wasn't happy with Naomi for buying her own house and just leaving him. But seriously, what if that's all it took? What if that's all it took? I think you talked about it, though. I think you said something. If Grandma decided to get her own place, Grandpa would say, well, screw ya, see ya. Do you think so? Or do you think he would... not as a manipulative tactic, not as like a grandma, call him on his bluff and see if he comes crawling back to you, go buy your own house. No, I think just like, I think you mentioned before that if Grandpa opens up Westwood, no, if Grandpa does the Theron Pollard School for the kids in Salt Lake, the grandma was not going to be there. Having that type of boundary, having that type of ultimatum, she can go find her happiness if he wants to go do whatever the heck he wants to do. Because if he wants to be selfish right now, grandma gets to be selfish too. But if he wants a wife and she wants a husband, then there's got to be some sort of compromise. But grandma's been compromising for far too long, so it's grandpa's trying to compromise. So yeah, I think, I'm not really sure what I'm saying. I'm just pretending like I know, I guess. I'm just saying grandma needs to speak her truth and make her boundaries and say, I'm not coming back there until you stop working. There's no point in coming back if you're not going to be home with me. There's no point in coming back if you're not going to spend your days with me. I don't want to spend my days with a man that's a workaholic and not able to have a conversation past his own nose. I mean, really, I think she could find her power still, even though she's so close to giving up, and even though she's had such a hard time with him. I don't think it would change him, but she could still hold her power and just find her happiness wherever she wants to find it. Okay, Alexa, set timer for 10 minutes. Sorry, I forgot to do that earlier.
10 minutes, starting now.
Okay, here we go. This is a difficult one for me. I really loved your invitation about me coming up to Vegas. I love it so much. Love it, love it, love it, love it. And then later on, you asked me about I wouldn't be able to leave the parking lot. I'll have to get to that subject in a second. Let me get through the rest of these notes here. Spencer doesn't like guests, neither does Jim, so I understand that. I think it's a social thing. Jim's really particular, very rigid, very, very, very Asperger's-like. Asperger's is very high-functioning from autism, and Jim's very anti- social unless it's a one-on-one controlled environment where he can control the dialogue, where he can feel like he's understanding the topic at hand. If he doesn't understand the topic at hand, if he doesn't feel knowledgeable, he's super uncomfortable. If someone's invading his space, he's super uncomfortable. My son is just like that, and my husband's just like that, so I'm noticing the similarities in that. You mentioned that you're always gauging and doing the temperature check for him because he's uncomfortable with people coming over and uncomfortable with people staying, and it's just so much easier not to have people come over when our spouse is going to be on edge and having issues with people. I totally understand that. I remember you telling me that you thought you always had to have a valid reason why you were leaving Richard. And you were telling me this again because I was telling you how much I desire an opportunity to start over fresh. And the valid reason that you thought you had was to go out and find the girl that he was cheating on you with so that you could get that validation from other people, so that you could give them the proof and they could say, yeah, Di, you should totally leave him. And that would give you the permission that you were seeking, that you needed. And I noticed that's what I do. I noticed that I'm looking for the permission from others. And I have done that. And now that I've gotten all the permission in the world, I got grandpa's position, permission. That was a big one for me when he gave me permission. I've gotten my children's permission. That was huge, huge permission. Like, they both are fine with me leaving him if I need to. I didn't come right out and say it, but they wanted to make me feel better. I was crying one day and I just said, I'm so tired of fighting. I don't want to fight anymore. Like, we don't want you to fight either. And I says, I'm trying not to fight, guys, but I can't let him walk all over me. I can't let him tell me what to do all the time. That's not okay either. I'm trying to make this work the best I can. I don't want to leave your father, but I feel like that's the only way I'm going to be able to stop fighting with him. And they says, yeah, we would rather you leave him than to fight with him. We would rather see you, they didn't say see me happy. I think they said, we would rather you'd get divorced too than just do the fighting anymore. I think that's what how they said it. And they said it at different times, at different conversations in their own way. And it just brought me so much peace knowing that if that's what I need to do, I know it would be best for them. And I seriously, if I had the money today, I would, after last night's fight, I would really seriously consider it. And then I'll forget about my conviction and I will go back into my hopefulness and my naiveness and all that stuff. Anyways, I got lots of validation and permission to leave, but I guess I'm still scared to do it. All right, now it's going back into Vegas talk. Let me skip over that for just a second and get through to this rest. Oh, I only have the rest of the page. Cool. Okay, so Chrislyn, yes, poor girl. And I really appreciate you reminding me that at that age, she's looking for people she wants to emulate. She's looking for people she wants to be like and who she appreciates in her life. And so, yes, thank you for acknowledging that I could give her some good traits. I really appreciate that. And I think what you sent to Christopher is fine. He's going to be absent for a little bit. I recognize the stage that he's in right now. I think he's in a hole right now, emotionally, and just trying to function the best he can on the outside. And that is absolutely no phone calls, no text messages, no social media, nothing. He has not replied back to me. He will not take a call. He will not anything. He's really struggling right now. And what I just found out on Thursday or Friday was that Chrislyn doesn't want to go to Georgia. I think I told you about that. But then I found out more information, which was Chrislyn's mom filed a junction against Christopher. And now Christopher's going to have a hearing because now they're accusing Christopher of doing what Jackie did to Christopher, which was alienate the children. And the reason why Chrislyn doesn't want to go to Georgia is because of Jackie's own doing. Jackie beats her daughter up verbally over the phone or over Marco Polo or, I just thought of something. There's a guardian ad litem. I don't know if you've ever heard of that. I've never heard of that before this case. There's a guardian ad litem. According to what I understand, Christopher doesn't have custody of the kids and Jackie doesn't have custody of the kids. Like legal decision-making power over the kids. That's what I mean. They are a ward of the state. Alexa, stop. They are a ward of the state, and the guardian ad litem is the guardian of the children. Because of what Jackie did to Christopher, she stole the children away. He never lost custody. He tried to stay in contact as often as possible, but she would change her number. She moved from Arizona to Georgia without telling anyone. She kept the children hidden, wouldn't go to court hearings, wouldn't go to therapy sessions once the court found her and told her she had to go to court. And she would tell the children to hang up on their father. So for years, they didn't have a relationship, Christopher and the kids. So this alienation that she did was so severe that the courts finally saw it. And Jackie lost custody of her kids, like legal custody, while they were in her care, like a foster parent type of thing. It's her children and she's taking care of them. She can't make legal decisions for them. The children were now a ward of the state, and the guardian ad litem had to decide what was best for the children. And so now Jackie could be held in contempt if she didn't take the children to their court-ordered therapy, if she didn't do the required Skype visits with Christopher and encourage the children to speak to them. And if she didn't follow all the things that the guardian ad litem told her to do and the judge told her to do, then she could lose custody of her kids. So she was warned years ago about this. And finally, once the therapist kept reporting back to the guardian ad litem what is in the best interest of the children, and they saw severe alienation and how different the children were with Christopher through Skype and through their mom, as soon as their mom comes in the room or as soon as they know their mom's around. Wow, crazy, crazy, like manipulative, toxic stuff going on with these children, right? That they see their mom and they just freeze and they won't talk to their dad on Skype anymore. It's like, Jackie, you need to wait outside. Well, we're running late. We gotta go. No, this is their session with their father. You need to go. And then all of a sudden, you know, the mom leaves, and because they know the mom's outside and they know the mom's agitated and whatever, we gotta go, Christopher, instead of dad. You know, mom's gonna be mad if we don't go. So the therapist saw that and told guardian ad litem that this is severe alienation. They are very influenced by their mother and they need to go. They need to be in a different environment. So that was the recommendation of the therapist to the guardian ad litem. The guardian ad litem had an emergency hearing. Christopher and Ashley and Yvette and the kids came up from Arizona with this emergency hearing possibility that Christopher might get custody, physical custody. And yeah, I think I've told you most of this, but I don't think I've told you how severe it is. The guardian ad litem told the judge all this, and Christopher had it all recording on his smartwatch, so I got to listen to the whole thing. It was awesome. And Jackie and the lawyers couldn't say anything. They had absolutely nothing to, they tried to bark, and they tried to whine, and they tried to throw Christopher under the bus, but they had nothing. Everything was against Jackie on that court hearing day about the severe alienation. So ever since that day that Jackie lost her children, all she does is bark orders at Chrislyn, and she makes Chrislyn feel bad if she doesn't, you know, write to her enough or call her enough. Or, you know, Jackie wasn't allowed to talk to the kids for like 6 months. And of course they don't want to alienate the mother from the children, but they needed to do it in a healthy way where it was reunification. Jackie needed to go to camp counseling and parenting classes, and the kids needed to have a chance to rebond with their father before their mother comes back into their life. And ever since their mom came back into their life 6 months, you know, things were going well for a little while. Christopher was starting to bond with them. And then as soon as Jackie comes back, now the children are torn, and it's been a hell of a road since 2018 for Christopher. So I'm really getting all this third hand because Christopher won't talk to me very much. I've talked to him just a little bit, and that's only when he's feeling good. But anyways, what's going on right now is Jackie is accusing Christopher of doing the same thing because Chrislyn is learning how to find her voice. She's learning how to tell the therapist and tell her mom that she doesn't want to talk to her right now, and she doesn't want to go to Georgia this summer. And she only is saying that because she knows how toxic her mom is. But instead of her mom recognizing that in herself, she's now trying to get Christopher in trouble for alienating. And yeah, there's just so much that Christopher's going through. And I don't know why I have to tell you as if I'm excusing him for not replying. I know you don't expect him to reply or anything. You even said that in your Marco Polo to him. I'm not saying that. I guess I'm feeling really bad for him. And I've always had this motherly, overprotective, big sister feeling towards him. Like he's either not doing well enough or like he's really getting the shit end of the stick, you know? So I can't seem to shake my disgust in Jackie and what she's done to him and the kids. I just really wish that she would try to make it a win-win situation, but she doesn't want to. She wants it all her way, and she will stop at nothing. Real stuff underneath genuine. Okay. Yeah. I recognize what you were saying. Thank you for helping me find the words. Yeah. It's not that we're not real when we're first initially talking to someone we haven't talked to in a while. I like what you said. It's just, we're genuine, but we're genuine on a surface level. And most of us are anyway. And then we just want to get to the stuff underneath. We want to get to the real things that are going on. And yeah, it is hard living in a different state. And then you mentioned that you were around family with helping RJ and the COVID closing down your shop. My question to you was, when you saw them as often as you did you feel like you missed them? Did you feel like you regretted being so far away in Vegas? And did you like think about closing up shop permanently and moving back to Idaho to be with Spencer? Is that still a thought that comes in? I know that you've resolved quite a bit about enjoying being with CJ and the grandkids in Vegas, so I understand why you didn't make that decision. But I'm just wondering if you felt torn at all, if you felt torn between all of those great feelings that you had being up there and the great feelings that you have of being CJ and the kids down there. What if CJ, okay, CJ's got his job down there. I was gonna say, what if CJ and the kids moved up to Pocatello too, or Idaho Falls or whatever? Then they wouldn't have to be around their mother, but then that wouldn't be good. Nobody wants to be without their mom. I don't care how bad their mom is. Nobody wants to be without them. Even Chrislyn, she just wants her mom to be soft and loving and not crazy. And then my last thing says Marco Polo C. What the heck was a C? What was I saying? C. I don't know. I don't know what I wrote down. Marco Polo C. I don't know. S-E-E. I don't know what I was saying. So I'm gonna go back up to the invitation to Vegas idea and me hanging out with you and me, whatever. I am not upset at all that you invited me. I'm actually super challenged with this. Challenged in a I would like to take on this challenge sort of way. I'm very inspired. What is the word? Motivated, encouraged. I don't know what the word is. I want to overcome my codependency so much. That's definitely a boss level for me. Boss level. You know what I'm talking about with boss level? Like when you play a video game and you're on the first level, it's super easy. Anybody could pass the first level. And then the second level is just a little harder than the first. And the third is a little harder than the second. And you get through the levels and they just get harder and harder as you go. But because you were practicing so well, you're skilled now. And by the time you get to the end of the game, you're on the boss level and you're beating the boss. You're beating the bad guy. You're beating the hardest level ever. I think the hardest level for me in this codependency thing is going on a trip without my husband. I've done it twice in the 15, I've been with him almost 15 years that I've known him. Both times was in October of 2005. I'm pretty sure. September of 2005 and October 2005. Doesn't matter. What I'm saying is that they were rather quite close to each other because my mom was heading to Florida on a job trip in 2005 and I went with her. It was planned. I was helping her paint a lady's house in Florida. She lives in Florida instead of Arizona because she moved there for retirement, but she had my mom painted her house in Arizona and the lady wanted to pay my mom to come out to Florida to paint her new house. And my mom took me with her to help her drive, to keep her company and to help her, you know, wash brushes and, you know, paint base coats and lay down masking tape and stuff like that. So I wasn't working full time. I didn't have a committed job. I had two part-time jobs and I was able to get off work and go with her. And I committed myself to go with her, but then I met Jim and I quit my part-time jobs and I didn't have something steady when she asked me if I wanted to go, and I was gonna make good money and I was gonna be gone a week. So I was doing it. I'd only known Jim for 2 months, August, September, October. Yeah, 2 to 3 months. I'd only known him for a short time, but we were rushing really quickly. And I went, even though he was pissed off about it, even though he was angry, even though he was hurting, even though he was crying and shaking and not sleeping and throwing guilt trips and yelling and screaming. Like, he went through all kinds of gamut of emotions. And I had such a hard time going, but I went anyway because my mom expected me to, and it was something I committed to, all of that stuff. The entire time I was driving, we had to drive there. The entire time we were driving, he was texting me. He was calling me. We get to the hotel. He wants to know what hotel I'm at. He wants to know if I see any guys around. He wants to know which rooms are next door. He wants to know, like, I taught him how to treat me by not standing up to him even then. And I caved, I catered, I fawned. I did everything imaginable to show him that, dude, I'm not cheating on you. Dude, everything's fine. Dude, you're gonna be okay. We get all the way to Florida and he is so beside himself with grief. He wants to know which hotel I'm at, which city I'm at, how long am I gonna stay there? When am I coming home? I don't think I can handle it. You guys just went to the sushi restaurant last night and I don't know who you met. Like, it was so, I have not thought about this in a long time. It was so bad that my mom was freaking out. Like, Crystal, this is not good. Crystal, you need to just, and she knows that she's had her fair share of drama husbands, that she knew that no matter what she said to me, I was gonna do it my way. And so she just rolled her eyes and got irritated a couple times, but then just let it go as best she could. I wish she would have put her foot down more, honestly, now that I think about it. I don't know how I would have. I needed to learn, I guess. Like, I must have, because I can't blame her. But anyways, next thing I know, he's calling me from the airport, and he's telling me he's getting a taxi cab to come to my hotel. He flew. He got a plane ticket, and he flew from Phoenix, Arizona to Gainesville, Florida. I think that's where we were at. And I'm like, what the fuck? Like, I'm living with this man. I'm wanting to marry this man. And he's acting like a crazy stalker, knowing where we were, knowing how long we were going to be there, and he could not handle it. He tried claiming it was a surprise, and he just wanted to surprise me, and he knows how much I missed him and all that, and he missed me too, and so he thought it was a romantic gesture, and I tried to convince myself that it was, but I thought it was kind of like, what the fuck? What the hell, dude? What are you doing? And the entire drive home, instead of me sitting up front with my mom, keeping her company, keeping her awake, keeping her entertained, all that stuff, you know, while she's driving, I'm in the back with Jim, and it was a minivan we were driving. I'm in the back with Jim, loving him, kissing him, making him feel better, making him feel loved, making him feel like everything's okay. I'm sorry that those few days were hard for you. I'm sorry that I didn't text you enough or call you enough. I'm sorry. Like, do you see what I did? Do you see how I'm accountable for teaching him how to treat me? I taught him that everything he was doing was fine. That's not cool. I think I've talked way more than 20 minutes. I just realized that. I'm just saying, like, this was one of our biggest red flags that I should have, would have, could have, wish I would have known better. But I was 24 years old, desperate to have children, feeling so insignificant because of my ex, feeling like I would never find someone as good as Jim, and willing to bend over backwards for him. I had nowhere to go. I had nobody to move in with. I had already moved all my stuff up to El Mirage. Like, what the hell was I thinking? I thought I could help this man. I thought I could make him feel better. I thought my love would be enough. That was actually the first time he accused me of staring at somebody. We were at a gas station, and he tells me this story all the time, that that he was talking, and instead of me looking at him, I was looking past him, and past him was gas pumps, and there was guys filling up their motorcycles with gas. I don't remember this. Now, okay, tell me. You know the family enough. You know how Dolly, and I think Eileen did it too, and maybe others do it. These are the two people that I remember doing it the most. When they're looking at something, without blinking, I'm blinking right now, but when they're looking at something, they get fixated on it, and they just get fixated on it, and they're like, not even like, paying attention, uh-huh, yeah, mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, what? Like, I have that stare. I have that Dolly stare or that Eileen stare. Like, I don't know if that makes sense to you, if you've ever noticed it, but there's a stare that happens when we're in deep thought, and it looks like our eyes are fixated on something, and it probably is, but it's not in our awareness, and it's not something I'm aware of. And I've been trying to explain this to Jim for years, but because of that moment of him thinking I'm staring at guys, hot guys, I guess, I don't know if they were hot, filling up their motorcycle tanks with gas, I guess this has been the anthem to our relationship, that he thinks I stare at guys. He thinks that I'm going to cheat. He thinks I'm going to leave him. He thinks that he's not worthy enough for me to stay faithful to him. And it doesn't matter how many times I've proven to him that I am faithful. He'll use every excuse in the book to prove to me why I'm not. He'll use every example he can, even if it's not true. So, wow, I just can't believe how crazy it is. It's really crazy, isn't it? That wasn't the first time. I just realized that. That must have been like January or February. I don't remember when that was. Nope, I think it was February. Doesn't matter. The first time I went out of town and he flipped out, that was when I was in Idaho for the Christmas party when Christopher had his diabetic coma. That was my first taste of what he was like. It doesn't matter. Okay, but what I'm trying to say is that you asked me in that question, what would Jim say? What would Jim say if I told him I was going? He'd be like, what? No, that's what he would say. Or he would say, fine, go, but you can't come back. Or fine, go, but you're not welcome here anymore. And don't ever think that you will ever be able to make this relationship work if that's what you're choosing to do, right? He might also say, I knew it. I knew you didn't really love me. I knew that you only want to think about yourself. You're so selfish. You know, he would say stuff like that. So if I got past all of those responses, okay, because those are the ones I know he would say, one of those, depending on his mood. If I got past all of those and I went, then if I came back, I would never hear the end of it, ever. I would always be in debt to him because I did that to him. He would always be a victim because I did that to him. So he wouldn't forgive. He wouldn't forget. He wouldn't approve of it. Even if he gave me permission in a non-cynical way, he would still remind me of how fucked up it was that I had to do that. I had to do that to him, that I had to do that for myself. And I say that because I haven't done anything so daring ever, but I've done other things that are very similar. I've done other things that he's reminded me of how terrible I was for doing them, okay? Now, you said something about if you were to buy me a ticket and say, hey, Crystal, this is for you to come spend the weekend with me, blah, 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 whatever, okay? Then it's just a collaborated effort on, oh, now your aunt knows all about our problem and knows all about my jealousy, and she's trying to get you away from me, and she's trying to take you to a strip club. That was hilarious, by the way. I cracked up laughing when you said that, because I got to thinking, like, I'm thinking, like, seriously, like, okay, could I do it? 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 And I'm like, you know what? I would probably have a better chance of going now when everything's closed than I would if everything got opened. If he knew all the casinos were closed, if he knew that the strip joints were closed, if he knew that Vegas is shut down, and he knew that I was only going to your house, for example, that might be completely different than me going to Vegas to have a good time without him. He won't even take me to Vegas to have a good time with him. Do you see how this goes? Vegas with him is such a scary thought. I can't even go to the gym with him, guy. How am I supposed to go to a freaking another state and another city in the sin city of all cities? Yeah, it ain't gonna go over well. It ain't gonna go over well at all. Here's what I'm thinking, okay? Here's what I'm thinking. I'm working this out in my head, okay? Someday, it might be soon, it might be later, but someday I'm going to build up these boundaries little by little, more and more, and someday he's going to go back on a boundary that he cannot recover from. He might do something so terrible, so wrong, so hurtful, that I will leave for the weekend. And I won't come back. Not at least for the weekend. Whether I'm living in this room or going to stay with my mom, I'll turn off the location on my phone because he has a tracker app on my phone. I will make sure the children are taken care of, or maybe I'll bring them with me. I probably would bring them with me if that's okay. In my mind, the only way I'm going to be able to do anything like this on my own is by taking a stand for myself and just ripping off the mandate and doing it. But I got to know. I got to know that it's because I'm holding a boundary, it's because I'm standing up for myself, it's because he doesn't deserve to have his tabs on me. Do you know what I mean? Am I making any sense? Probably not. Here's another way of looking at it too, because I'm really back and forth in my mind, as you can clearly see. My husband is not mentally okay. My husband is not well. And if I marry this man in sickness and in health, better for worse, all that stuff, what kind of person would I be to do something in the face of his illness? If I know it's deliberately going to make his illness worse. Like, shock therapy is good for some things, but it needs to be done in a loving way. You are safe. You are fine. Everything's going to be okay. Like, he needs to want to heal. He needs to want to see me go on a trip. And he, you know what I'm saying? And if I just shock him into it, he'll be resentful. He'll be angry. He'll regress in any of his progress. So the only way I can do it on a heart of fuck him, I'm doing this anyway. I don't care what he thinks and all that stuff. He's got to have messed up. I can't just be cold about it when my whole philosophy with this man is, you're not well, and I think I can make you feel better. Okay, well, I've dropped the latter part. Now I'm just saying, you're not well, and I'm going to do what I can, but I can't help you. I'm going to do what I can to not make it worse for you, but I can't help you. So I don't want to make things worse for him. And I think me being in this bedroom, he's trying to use that as his, this is worse for me. This is worse than you sleeping in the bed next to me. Well, I'm sure it is, but you know what? You don't get to have me right now. And I'm sorry. I'm sorry that that hurts you. I'm sorry that you feel a need to have someone next to you all the time. Stop being so damn needy. I've talked a long time. I want to apologize for it because I don't feel like I have a whole lot of valuable things to say. But then I remind myself that I am valued, and I do have a lot of great things to say, and I appreciate you helping me recognize that, helping me acknowledge that in myself, that I, whether I have an audience or not, whether I have my aunt die listening or not, I'm still valuable. I still have a voice. I still have a voice that I've not allowed to speak for so very long, and I've got a lot of years to catch up on, or at least allow myself to speak when I'm giving myself permission to speak. So yes, me writing these notes and talking to you out loud is super helpful. It's helping me find my voice. It's helping me hear about a subject and go, let me tell you about this. And well, let me tell you about this too. And well, let me work this out. Well, I want to get back to the biggest thing, because I need to go through this, and then I'm going to talk about that. Like, it's really helping me organize my thoughts, because prior to reading the notes and you talking about FAQs, I'm like, no, I can't do that. I know I mentioned it. I know you mentioned it. I know we're on the same wavelength, and we both think it would be cool. But my codependency is super strong here. Like, I don't want to make it worse for him. And even though he's choosing his experience and he's making it worse for himself, I could not. I'd have to be kidnapped. And my phone location would have to be turned off. And there'd have to be a pint of blood on the ground outside to make it look like there was an assault. I'd have to have detectives looking for me. I'd have to have missing poster signs up for a while. I'd have to be, is that silly that I'm like fantasizing about that? That's not good. Oh my gosh. I've never been this honest with anybody out loud. Ever. I've been speaking like this to myself for years because I needed to get it out, and I'm just super grateful that you're listening. I got this voice in my head that wants to remind myself that it's not that bad, and that I'm exaggerating, and that I'm full of it, and I've got that doubt in my mind that doesn't understand that everybody has their problems, and I don't need to be so dramatic, and Crystal, you're not innocent. Like, am I making sense? Like, I'm not crazy. I feel like I am. I have that voice in my head. Look at this. It's not all one way, and it's not all the other way. Life is like a bicycle. It might be a little crazy. Jim might be a little psycho. I might be a little exaggerating. Jim might be a little abusive. I don't think it's as bad as the way I fear it is, but it definitely is not as healthy as it should be. So I'm trying to find my balance. I showed you my apron earlier, right? Isn't that so stinking cute? I'm absolutely loving my bicycles. It's a super helpful visual reminder for me to... Because here, even if all of what I just said about wishing that I could be kidnapped and just escape my life for a few days, even if I feel like it's that bad in that moment, I can't allow myself to think that it's that bad. Because when I allow myself to think it's that bad, I fall apart. I go into a hole I can't get out of. I get super depressed. I get super down on myself. That's when the suicide thoughts start coming up. That's when I feel like there's no escape. That's when I feel like there's no hope. That's when I can't see my strength. That's when I forget about my power. So I cannot lean that far on the bicycle. I cannot lean that far on the bicycle and recognize things for how they are all the time. When I recognize things for how they are all the time, it is a super dark place. Even if they really are that way. Even if all that I'm saying is true about how bad it is. And then I don't want to be like my mom either, because that's too far the other direction on the bicycle. My mom thinks that she has to be happy all the time, and if she's not happy, then there's something wrong with her. And if she can't see the positive in a situation, then there must be something wrong with her. And I recognize myself making excuses for him and finding leniency and saying, oh, well, he's not doing well. He's mentally not well, and I can't hurt him like that. Like, I recognize that all of those are just, it's just my denial, and it's just my positivity, and it's just, you know, positivity is not always great when it's keeping us stuck in a situation, you know, a bad job, a bad marriage, you know, a bad financial situation. My mom was noticing that Uber was dying down when COVID started, right? And she wasn't getting as many rides when the bar started closing. And Calissa and Ashley pushed my mom to stop working because they were worried about my mom catching it and worried about, you know, spreading it and all that. So they encouraged her to stay home. What was I trying to say here? So then Calissa helps my mom get her taxes caught up because she hadn't paid taxes in years. I helped my mom collect unemployment. So we're applying for unemployment and stuff. And we're trying to figure out how mom's going to survive once these resources run out, once her stimulus runs out, once her, you know what I mean? And as we're talking, we're asking mom if there's something else that maybe she could do as a different job where she's a little more safer, or maybe she can work from home somehow, or would she be willing, you know, to teach an online class about art or piano or singing or something, right? And it didn't matter what we were trying to help mom with. She was so positive and so much in denial about what was going on with her financial situation that she just kept saying, I'm gonna win the lottery. So what I'm trying to say is, I don't want to be so gloom and doom that I've got no hope left, and I don't want to have so much hope that I'm not being practical here. So I'm really trying to find my bicycle and ride it without falling. And that's why this room helps me, because it's helping me climb out of my hole long enough to recognize that I'm valuable. It's helping me recognize that I'm worthy of being treated kindly, and I'm worthy of having peace and privacy and respect, and I'm worthy. And I can't believe that I kept forgetting how worthy I was, because I just kept telling him he was more important than me by my actions, by giving him what he wanted and not asking for anything that I needed. And this room also helps me stay grounded enough to show my kids and to show my husband that What? That I'm not giving up? What am I showing them? That I'm not a monster? What do I care about what they think? Why? Because of course they're my kids. They're my husband. It's my husband. I'm codependent to what they think. Why? Why am I here? I'm here because I can't financially make it on my own. That's gotta be false too. That's gotta be false too. There's a lot of women that make it on their own on less than what I make. I'm just scared to make it on my own, so that's why I'm here. I'm here because I'm scared. I'm scared about a lot of things. That's why I bought the necklace that I still can't find. Okay, this is my last video before I go, right? I think I told you at some point to remind me of things to show you. And I'm going to show you two things, because I remember two of the things. I don't remember how many things I told you to write down. Do you remember that? One of my first videos, I said, I've got stuff to share with you about codependency. So right now I'm going to share with you a YouTube video about a woman who really gave me this insight, how codependency, not codependency, about how a lack of boundaries is selfish. And you don't think of it that way. People don't think of it that way because a lack of boundaries is typically someone that lets someone walk all over them, right? Or they walk on others. And when you walk on others, yeah, that sounds selfish, duh, right? But when you allow others to walk on you, why? Why do we do that? Why do we let people take advantage of us? Well, because we're afraid of them being mad at us if we don't let them. We're afraid of them not liking us if we don't do what they ask us to do. So we are really only letting people walk all over us because we are selfish and we don't want to face our fears and we don't want to confront the people that are hurting us. We are wanting comfort, and it's uncomfortable to confront things, and it's uncomfortable to speak our truth, and it's uncomfortable to stand up for ourselves and hold our boundaries. She helped me see that, so maybe she has a better way of explaining it than I just did. And the second thing I want to share with you is a podcast. It's about 20 minutes, and it talks about the different levels of boundaries. I watched the podcast before. I mean, I listened to the podcast before I watched the YouTube video, and I don't think it matters which order you go in. I think the YouTube videos is like 8 minutes long. I don't remember, though. And if there was something else I was going to show you, which I know there is, I'm just not remembering. And the reason why I bring up the selfish thing and the boundaries thing is because I recognize that right now, that the reason why I'm in this room is because I'm too selfish to leave. I want my cake. I want to eat it too. I want my marriage to stay together. I want my kids to have their home. I want to feel comfortable and not rip off the Band-Aid and not tell them we're done and not tell them I'm tired of them and can't do this anymore. Like, I keep thinking that there's some sort of reward for putting up with him. Like, he's going to change and it's going to be he's going to give me all the credit. Or what the fuck am I waiting for? What am I waiting for? Is it really money? Is it really strength? Is it really power? What am I waiting for? Am I ready right now? I don't know. I don't think so. But just me speaking out loud really helps. It helps me question me. It helps me question my brain. Oh, I got one more thing I want to show you before I show you those things. There was an analogy. I don't know if I shared it with you. It's in one of the Ogmandino books. I think I shared it with you not too long ago. Basically, the advice was, the arrow doesn't point just anywhere and still hit a target. It has to be pointed at a target before it can hit a target. You can't just go, let's see what happens and hope for the best and hope that it hits your target. First of all, you gotta know what your target is before you can even call it a target. And second of all, yeah, if I'm on the fence and I'm back and forth and I'm wishy-washy, do I wanna leave him, do I wanna stay, do I wanna leave him, do I wanna stay, then that's an arrow that's rubbery. That's an arrow that's like a noodle. Like, it doesn't have any firm direction. It's not pointing anywhere. It's just down in here, come down there. So when I read that part in the Law of Success, that if you want success, you've got to have an aim. What are you aiming towards? Am I aiming towards divorce? Am I aiming towards staying and making my marriage work? And so I read that about, what, a month ago? And I'm like, yes, I love that. I love that. And so I figured out what I wanted my aim to be. My aim is going to be that I'm going to be healed. I'm going to get better. I'm going to not do the codependent thing anymore. And once I'm feeling better, then I can invite a good marriage. And I've been saying that for over a month now. Okay? So a part of that, this is what I wanted to show you. I bought this at Michael's today. And I bought it for this room. Can you see what it is? It's kind of hard to see. I don't know if you can see it, but it's a shelf. Okay? So it's a shelf. Oh, there's a picture of it. So there's the shelf. You see the arrow? You see the arrow? Isn't that stinking cute? Jim says it looks like a farmhouse design. And it probably is, but it's metal. It's something. Okay. And then my mom gave me the bicycle mug. And I wanted a place to put mugs. Because I have a few mugs. I have a few mugs that I want to display. I don't drink out of mugs very often. And when I do, I can come get a mug. But I want to display my mugs more than I want to drink out of them. So that's why they're not in the kitchen. And I know it's going to be weird to have a bedroom with mugs in it. But I just... The arrow thing really spoke to me because it doesn't matter how long I aim towards this thing I'm aiming at. I understand the analogy really well, that the law of attraction doesn't work unless you have an aim. The law of attraction won't work in your favor if you don't tell the universe what your favor is. What would you favor? I favor that my aim is to freaking get strong and to get healed. And if my marriage survives, great. And if it doesn't, it doesn't. That's what my aim was for the last month. And now I'm sitting here and I'm questioning, why the heck am I staying? And I'm like, well, you're staying because your aim was to get better for you. And then see if you can have a relationship with him. But I don't think we can. I'm not exaggerating with that. Like, there's just two. Oh my gosh. I don't know. I can't make a decision tonight, of course. I have a lot of doubt right now. I have a lot of insecurities. practical, logical ones, not emotional ones, you know? Like last night, I don't know if I told you, I can't remember what I've said, I'm sorry. Last night, I showed him a video about, if you want to look up Jordan Peterson, he's a doctor in Canada. Jordan Peterson has these videos, and I watched one that said, get to know your future spouse or something like that, or choosing your future spouse. I don't know what it says, something about future spouse. And I told my husband that the reason why I want to show this to him is because, as far as I'm concerned, the relationship that we have is over, We need to build a new foundation. We need to build from scratch. We need to relearn each other and renegotiate things about our marriage and see if this is going to work. And this guy was talking about how important it is to be mature and dedicated and sophisticated in a conversation that may not be okay with the person you're with. So if they can't come to an agreement and you can't come to an agreement, then that's when you guys can negotiate. And if you still can't, you probably shouldn't get married. You probably shouldn't. It shouldn't be one person's way and the other person has to just live with it. Both parties should be satisfied with the outcome, with the negotiation. And there might be things you have to sacrifice, but you have to be satisfied with that sacrifice. You can't just let someone run you all the time, right? So he didn't say it the way I'm saying it. He was very positive and lighthearted about it. And there was nothing wrong with the way he delivered it. But of course, my husband likes to bring up the past and say that he didn't know who I was when I got, he thought I knew who I was. And obviously I was not that person. And just a big fight that happened afterwards. So what am I saying? I'm saying that over and over for 2 hours, I kept saying, so if I'm showing you a video that says in order for a couple to be successful in the future, they need to be able to communicate and come to a negotiation. And here you are arguing with me about why you can't negotiate. You're just proving the freaking video to you just made its point that we are not ready to have a relationship. Not now. I don't know about the future, but not now. We are not in any position to communicate right now. Every time we communicate about anything difficult, our fights get worse. We are quick to temper. We are quick to anger. We are quick. And by we, I mean, he gets to be irritated and frustrated and lonely and sad and rejected and accountable and whatever feelings that he's going through. He gets to feel that his wife left him and is in her own bedroom. And even though I haven't physically left, it's messing with him, I'm sure. It's messing with his emotions.